While they're doing that, you can turn to Genesis chapter 15. Genesis 15. And so the first verse in Genesis 15 says this: after these things, the word of the Lord came unto Abram in a vision. Okay. So after what things? He just flat out named all of it. He didn't just hit the highlights. Amen. But the highlight and probably the thing that is it is trying to get across about these things is having met Melchizedek, he met the God that he is the high priest to, the priest to the Most High God, the possessor of heaven and earth. It's interesting when you think about it. I mean, you know, people say, well, Melchizedek is a type and a shadow of Jesus and his priesthood. No. No. Jesus is a priest after the order of Melchizedek. Melchizedek was not a shadow. Melchizedek was a literal person who was a priest to the Most High God, the possessor of heaven and earth, and was in relationship with him and understood him as we, if you can recall the story, understood him in relationship to how he was and the real reality of the Most High God, the possessor of heaven and earth. Amen. We're in Genesis 15. Verse 1, except for we're hearkening back to verses in 14 because it begins with this. After these things, we want to just discuss the things that are precipitating chapter 15. And that was that Melchizedek was a priest to and for the Most High God, the possessor of heaven and earth. And remember, if you will, my conundrum over the years was I didn't understand how he could be the Most High God, the possessor of heaven and earth, that he was seen in light of, you know, I'm the highest and I got more stuff. Especially considering Christ crucified, especially considering the nature of Jesus as a slaughtered lamb, and that's how he's viewed on the throne, a slaughtered lamb. And, you know, it only takes a few minutes to come into that thought and go, now, how did that go? You know what I'm saying? How did we get something different out of the fact that it flat out says he's the Most High God, the possessor of heaven and earth? How do we come up with something that's lower than that? Well, the way we came up with that was that when he showed up in the person or the presence of Melchizedek the priest, the possessor of heaven and earth, the one who possesses heaven and earth, does not come with might and power. He does not come in flashy glory. He comes in the presence of his priest who presents a feast which consists of wheat seed. Remember Jesus said, except a seed fall into the ground and die, it abideth alone. But if it die, it brings forth much fruit. Also, the scripture says bread corn is bruised. And all of that seed is crushed to make bread. And the grapes that make the wine are grapes that are walked on and crushed. Back then they didn't have, you know, still in Italy and France, you know, many places. They still have people that have big vats that they walk on the grapes to prepare them. There's nothing most high in the way that he's presenting himself. There's nothing seemingly possessor, because what it looks like he possesses is what Jesus said, this is my body and this is my blood. Broken body, by the way. Poured out wine, by the way. And he presents that as a feast that he wants to commune with us on. And that we would comprehend him in this feast more than in his title. And yet in his title, we see something else. And that is, before I say that, we see how he comes to Abram. He comes to him after a great victory. But the greatness of that victory was that Abraham went to battle with 318 servants against Chedorlaomer's armies, not just his army, but the other kings that were with him, and defeated them with weakness, defeated them in lack, defeated them not in being what we would term the Most High God. It looks like the Most High God, the possessor of heaven and earth, has come to Abraham, and Melchizedek has that blessing from him. Blessed are you of the Most High God, possessor of heaven and earth. Well, Abram begins to comprehend this God who has brought his priest to him, and is acknowledging, not to anyone else, but is acknowledging to him that your victory didn't come by destroying everybody because you had greater power, because you had greater weapons, or because you had greater anything. But as a matter of fact, you went in weakness, trusting God that the battle would be yours. That's the only thing you got to trust in. Jesus went into battle, but he didn't go to fight. He went to lay down his life, and he defeated through death. He destroyed him that had the power of death, that is the devil. God forbid that I glory in anything but the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom I am crucified unto the world and the world unto me. Know ye not that the old man is crucified with him? On and on and on and on. The victory was a slaughtered lamb, not a really fierce, heavily armed lamb. One who laid down his life. And so we have Melchizedek introducing Abram to that. And Abraham's looking at the situation. He's looking at the Most High that does not seem that it's important to him to show himself as Most High. And possessor, okay, so the highest of everything and the possessor of everything. And yet, there's lowliness in his form, in his way. And so Abraham gives tithes, first mention of tithes. He gives, and he gives that to the Most High God. And he said, that's, you're worthy, okay. So now Abraham has won the battle. The war, really, if you want to go like that, because they didn't just have a battle. There was many battles before that that led up to Abram's men coming. And he wins the battle, and now in a very real way, he is the most high human in that area. King of Sodom, all the other kings come to him and go, you know, we couldn't defeat him, he defeated us. You saved us. He's also the possessor of all these kingdoms, all their stuff and all their people, right? I mean, because it says that. All those guys come to him at the same time Melchizedek came. Melchizedek spoke first. And then they say, give me this, give me that, give me, you know, you can keep this, but give me this. And Abram comprehends that what it means to be the most high is to get lower. And what it means to possess everything is to possess it, to have free will to possess it in giving it away. I possess it. Okay, good. I choose to give it to all you kings. You all take it. You take this, take that, whatever. Now, I am not going to take any credit from you as if you have done something to make me possessor. He saw that. He understood that to be a possessor didn't mean you gathered and gathered and gathered and gathered until everything was yours. Not to this God. To be a possessor is to have it given to you and you give it away. You don't hold on to it. Thank you, brother. And so he begins this process. I mean, if Melchizedek hadn't showed up first, there's a chance Abram might have thought, well, I'm the big shot now. I am going to possess the promised land now because they're all going to let me have it, because they're all go, man, you are a great military mind, you know, and you should be raised up. But Melchizedek showed up and said, this is your God. This is the God that you serve. And Melchizedek was a priest to that God who served communion to those who understood what he was like. So, nobody wants to agree with you gain by losing, and life comes out of death, and, you know, walking on grapes makes good wine. Or, you know, giving and not possessing. And when I say not possessing, what I mean is, Paul said it, having possessed all things and yet having nothing, because you're not a, in possessing it, you're not a person that's holding on to it. Like Paul and like Abram in this story. Choosing, you have free will to possess if you so desire. You can make it all about what your possessions are, but you have free will. But you have more than free will. You have the God of Melchizedek, who is the possessor of all of it, and yet he's not slinging it around, and he's not making it, you know, look like he's the king and lord of everything. He's just saying, eat this, feast with me. Come and feast with me on what I feast on. There's no other explanation for Abraham doing what he did. Here, you take tithes, you take your stuff, you take your stuff, you take your stuff. Go ahead. I am not going to let man say that you have done this. I give it, and if God wants me to have more or whatever, he'll do that. But my spirit isn't to hold on to it anyway. And here's the interesting thing is that in this chapter that we're reading, and even in this these verses right here that are coming up, verse 1 and 2, and his mind is somewhere else. I mean, he's with Melchizedek's God, because that's actually his God. You see, he didn't get a new God. He just found out deeper what his God was like. But his mind is somewhere else. His heart is somewhere else. And there is something he wants. But it's not possessions. And it's not position. What is it? A firstborn son. Right? All right. So let's read... starting with verse 1, chapter 15, up to 6. After these things, the word of the Lord came unto Abram in a vision, saying, Fear not, Abram, I am thy shield and thy exceedingly great reward. Okay, so get this. When he becomes a possessor and then does not possess it, then there is a reward, as it were, and that's more of the Lord. The Lord is your portion, because you're not depending on those things. You're not living off of those things, as it were. You live, you know, you walk by faith. You walk, you know, in relationship with him. And I thought it interesting when the Lord, right off, I mean, after these things, the word of the Lord came to him in a vision, Fear not, Abraham, I'm your shield. Okay? Folks, every one of us have a shield, and it's Jesus who died on the cross and bore everything that we should have borne. He's our shield. He's our shield. Okay? And so you begin to realize that's another step. This is the word of the Lord. This is God speaking to Abram. This is God not trying to impress him with anything, but trying to bring him into who he is. And by saying, I am your shield, he is saying, I will cover you and I will take the blows, as it were, Christ crucified for you. I'm sure that in these battles that just happened with all these kings, I mean, there were so many kings listed there, remember? I had a hard time pronouncing all their names. So many kings, so much war going on. I am sure that a few of those people had shields. What do you think? But their shields didn't work. They got defeated by 318 servants instead of mighty men. Of course, one of them was Conan the Barbarian, but anyway, not really. They had shields, man-made shields. Man-made shields to protect themselves. Because why? Because I guess the old saying is, if nobody will protect me, I'll have to protect myself. Well, you need to start living in a flow with the Godhead. Jesus, as it were, stood up for the Father. The Holy Spirit stood up for the Son. There was this constant shielding of one another, but not themselves. But we expect God, or we expect somebody to shield us when we're not in the flow of that nature. It's not love. God is love. It's not selfless giving. It is expectation of God's provision without living in the same manner towards Him. In other words, okay, there's a God. You're God. Now, you're God, and I'm down here, so take care of me. Period. No standing in the gap, no seeking, no putting Him before you so that He can put you before. See what I'm saying? No flow of the life of God, no flow of the life of love, but rather just kind of a general way that people view God. Well, He's God. He's got all the power and He's got all the possessions. He's the Most High God, possessor of heaven and earth. And their view of that is, you're supposed to do all the stuff for me, and the reason why you gave us a prayer life is so that we can pray over if I get sick or some loved one of mine gets sick or, you know, financial, you know what I mean? I mean, there's, what, 5-6 different categories that we use for prayer. There's 5 or 6 little, you know, areas. I mean, let's go ahead and be generous. Let's 10 areas that most people pray over. And almost all of those are pointed right back at themselves, okay? So that's what I mean by there's no flow of, you know, there's no, it's not, it's like there's no flow of going into the throne of grace and saying, you know, I never really have asked this, but I'd like to ask you what's going on, how you see things. What is your view? What are the things that are in your heart that you care about that I can do? I can pray. I can just stand with you. Open my eyes that I can be not just a warm body needing a God, but I can stand with you, assist you, as it were, in any way that I can. Not that you're saying, well, He's God, and, you know, I can help God on that front. It's rather being there, you know. You know, have you ever heard of a story? I think this is probably most common among wives, that they have a problem with their husband not being there. It's not traveling. That's not what I'm talking about. But they're just not in tune, you know. They're not there. They're present, but they're not there. You know, it's like, well, how do I reach you? How do I get a flow in this thing? Well, it doesn't start with drawing to self and then saying, when I get better or when I get my stuff, you know. I mean, I've heard that a million times. I mean, you just don't know, and not a million times, but I've been in ministry a long time, and I have heard so many pastors in pastors' meetings that they'll say, now, you know, we're just starting a church here, but when we get a big building, that's when we're really going to go or get a building. We got to have a building. Got to have a building. Okay. So the people that we do have, we're getting all the money we can out of them now so that we can get a building. And, I mean, the Lord told me early on, He said, how about you just minister to me and the people, and if enough people come, then I will expand the building, if you understand what I mean, the capacity according to that. But if, you know, and then He just showed me, if you're just this, we'll be really faithful to you and we'll be really involved when you give us a building. I don't, you know. Don't you believe that if this all of our buildings burned down. Don't say God forbid. Let them burn if that's the Lord's will, for God's sake. Because what is that end? Well, where would we meet? Oh, I don't know. We probably couldn't find anything. We just all have to die on the vine. You know what I mean? My Lord. Good grief, people. You know? We need to be more in tune with his heart, more in tune, more going after that. And I tell you what, it's not just because here's the deal. Jesus says, give and it shall be given unto you. Okay, well, to give is to lose. It's to give up, right? You know, give and it shall be given. So we go, okay, I'm going to give so I can get more. And he looks at that and he goes, you totally don't understand what being most high and possessor of heaven and earth is about. You only understand how you can get more. That's the way you see this. And then they get upset when they give a lot of money and then nothing happens. Where's God? He ain't looking for you, that's for sure. You know, you're working the system. You're working the system. Jesus says, give with no thought of return. Did you know it says that? No thought of return. How do you do that? Well, yeah, by the life of Christ he put in you. Because it's not in human nature to be this way. It's not. It's not in human nature to be that way. You just look at Adam and Eve in the garden, you know. Don't, you know, I got one commandment. Don't eat of that one. Bunch of trees in there. Plenty of trees. Even a tree of life over there, don't eat of that one. That's all I ask. Where does Eve show up at? And guess where the serpent's lurking? In the tree he said not to go to. You know. If God said that you can't eat of every tree, she should have said, no, he didn't say we couldn't eat of every tree. He said we can't eat of this one. We got all of this. But when he makes it like that, it sounds like you're so restricted. I can't eat of anything. God is dead. What has he done? He's choking, suffocating. You know? No, that's the, what's suffocating you is the devil's version. Amen. I mean, let us pause and meditate for a moment. Because so much that we think is the Lord's doing that, you know, you can say you should lay down your life and the devil will come and go, oh, that's, you know. I mean, he could say any number of things. You know, you don't want to do that. You know, now scripture says that and the Lord did it. But, you know, you wouldn't want to do that. I mean, what about your future? Yea, hath God said? You know? Well, we can get all wrapped up in everything except for the Lord's heart. But, it sounds almost impossible to get to know the Lord and get to know his heart. But how would you do that with anybody? What if you walked up to somebody that you'd known for years and you just said to them, you know what? I'd really like to know your heart. I'd like to know where your desires lay or what is important to you or how do you see things or, you know, that sort of thing. They might go, wow. Yeah, you're the first person in like 20 years to say something like that. But that's how it starts. You get off of you, and, you know, now if you just, you say, okay, I'm going to try what Randy said. You know, it needs to be something from the heart. You know what I mean? You need to really want that, or they'll catch on. And you don't want them to catch on, because then they'll go, you're just doing this to... Amen. So after these things, the word of the Lord came unto Abram in a vision, saying, fear not, Abram, I am your shield, and I am your exceedingly great reward. Okay, so here he is, exceeding great reward. Here he is, he's saying, don't worry about what you gave away, even though you might have done it in the spirit of the moment. Have you ever done that? You know, somebody's taking a big offering, and we're going to reach the world, and da-da-da-da, and pass out, and everybody's going, yeah, yeah, and then later go, oh, my God, what have I done? You know, how am I going to pay my rent? I have. That's how I know these things, not because I'm deep and wise, but because I've made most of the mistakes. But your reward is going to be the Lord. Is that okay? Would it be okay to say, I possess these possessions and I choose to, you know, and it's not, you know, but I choose to give whatever I want to whomever I want to without fear, because I have a shield and I have him as a exceeding reward. All right, so we go, oh Lord, I really want you. I made it. Give me Jesus or give me death. He'll say, death's on the platter there. Because, but then what's the replacement? What's the replacement? It's him, Christ in you, the hope of glory. Why is it a hope? Because we don't have it like we should. It's him. We have him full and complete when we accepted him, but we don't know him, and it certainly is not him functioning through, you know, all my heart and all my soul and all my might and all my, you know, certainly not him in those ways. It's like, you know, I love God, but that's mine, you know. I mean, because that's, you know, we don't think about, I love you with my mind. I love you with my strength, you know. I don't know, had a good example, but I shouldn't use it. I think that Abram really got a good dose of his God through Melchizedek mediating, and through the Lord, and through him saying, there's a blessing from the Most High God, the possessor of heaven and earth. And that blessing was, when you reduced yourself down to 318 servants and you went out on behalf of Lot and others, that's unusual. And Abraham gets it and he goes, okay, so then he's the possessor, but he's showing me that I'm supposed to be this way. And I've just become the Most High in the neighborhood and the possessor in the neighborhood, and I am going to follow what I've seen of him. Yeah. That's harder than it sounds. Because we see a lot of stuff and then we walk off and go, oh, I learned new stuff today. I'm getting really deep. I'm getting really deep. Yeah, you are. You're missing it. And then the Lord shows right after that. After these things, he shows up and he says, I'm shielding you, and I am your reward now. I am. Okay, so if the I am said, I am, we go, oh, yeah. And he goes, I am your reward. And you go, whoa, that's pretty good. That's pretty good. Because it's a joining into the I am. I mean, it'd be like a wedding. You're going through the vows. And you said to the bride, do you take this man to be your lawfully wedded husband? And she says, I am. Do you take da-da-da-da, I am. Not I do. Oh, I'm going to do it. There won't be any divorce here. Okay, well, good luck with that. I am. Preacher, see that guy? I am. You know what I mean? That oneness, that reality that is God, who is one, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, one God, three different personalities. You know, now, I don't know if I should share that. Man, that goes back a long way. He's still stopping me from sharing it. Verse 2, and Abram said, Lord God, what wilt thou give me, seeing I go childless, and the steward of my house is this Eliezer of Damascus? All right, so here we go. I mean, part of it is good, and part of it isn't. All right, let me just, maybe I should just read through, because I'm not doing that. Okay, after these things, after what thing? After Abram met the priest of the Most High and perceived the things that moved the one who seemed higher than any other and the one who possessed basically anything that could possibly be possessed. And so I remember when I wrote that, see, I can't seem to get off of Melchizedek and this God. I remember when I wrote that this God, he is the Most High over all those penny-ante kings down there and their armies, and he possesses all at his disposal, and he chooses Abraham and his 318 guys. Okay, so here's the deal. We think that we're pretty spiritual, but if God gave us an extreme amount of possessions or an extreme amount of power, position, Most High, there is a good chance that we would resort to those things. We could sit on our throne and look down and go, okay, that ain't right. Let's see, what do I got here? Hey, you, and take this and go remedy that. You know, make that either right or make it fit me. See? Because we will use what we have as if that's the important thing. He's the Most High and the possessor of heaven and earth, and all this was going on, and he didn't interject anything. He waited till his man got his 318 servants and went out and risked their life in weakness. And then he shows up. Melchizedek says, I'm here to bless you from the Most High God, the possessor of heaven and earth. I mean, Abraham could have said, well, then why didn't you bring your stuff? You know, instead of me and my 318 guys having to do it. He didn't do that. He comprehended that it was in the lowliness of that situation that moved God and his priest to him. Yes. So that's what I meant when I said the Most High, that Abraham perceived things that moved this one who seemed higher than any other and the one who possessed basically anything that could possibly be possessed, and moved him towards Abraham. What were those things that moved him? Not greatness or possessions. Most High and possessor. Not greatness or possessions. What were those things that moved him? Weakness when given in a particular sacrificial way. And I wrote down, what a paradox. So let us look at some of the things that transpired following Abraham's encounter. First off was the fact that his God immediately spoke to him in a vision. Along with that was the discovery that the God of Melchizedek, the priest, was the same God that was speaking to him now. To Abram, he did not change gods, but his understanding of his God was further extended, which is what he's always trying to do. But he's like a diamond that's been cut so many different directions and stuff that you can see so many facets and they all shine. And what did God declare to Abram this time? He told him not to fear because he was his shield and exceeding great reward. Basically, the Lord is explaining that Abraham need not worry in battle again or fret over the spoils of war, for he himself would see to it that he's protected and taken care of. Okay, so why would he do that with Abram? Well, because he showed weakness. Yes, of course, he showed faith in weakness, not just weakness. But also that God has figured out that this is the guy that's going to bring forth the firstborn son. He's a vessel. He's a vessel. Okay, now how many of you are a vessel of the firstborn son? Well, I saw one hand and a few head shakes. I didn't see any of these, but I did see this. If Christ is in you, he's the firstborn son that the Father wants. And that was the story in Exodus. Let my firstborn son go. And that's what he's saying all the time to us, folks. He is constantly in his heart saying, let my firstborn son go. Stop being, what does it say? Stop being ye as men, something like that. You know, quit ye as men. Quit. And be vessels that God calls a treasure inside of you. That treasure is his firstborn son. Let him go. Stop being Pharaoh. Stop holding back my firstborn. Stop enslaving my firstborn. Stop keeping him locked up while you live your life, and then resort to him every once in a while when you have a little earthly need. He's calling his son forth to you. But the point I was trying to make with Abram is he's also recognizes that you have his firstborn son. And that he's saying, I'm going to shield you. Oh, that's probably because I'm so special. No, because you know, that's like Mary, the mother of Jesus. You know, she's walking along the road, trips, a donkey cart breaks loose and runs over. Dang, that's sad. She could have brought forth Jesus, you know. Or, we don't know how many donkey carts didn't run over her, or how many situations that she was shielded from so that the baby would live, so that the seed would live. All right, so what are we saying on that? He's your shield too. But you need to quit letting him shield you from him. Right? Shielding you from the seed and from the Father. The father's going, I came to visit my son. Oh, he's busy. You know, he's in you, right? Yeah, oh yeah, he's there. He's back in the back. Could you let him go? Come see me just for a little bit? No, I have been really busy too. I've been more busy than him. He's been asleep out there in the boat in the backyard. Because we're so much the thing that we think God wants. He wants me. He needs me. He needs my ministry. He needs this. And he doesn't need any of that. He needs you to let his son go. And Abraham, and see, he hasn't announced yet that Sarah is going to also be through it, but he does make a big declaration here that Abraham hadn't heard before. Thank God that he finally gets it. Okay, so I wrote, let's see, after experiencing the reality of the slaughter of Chedorlaomer, meeting the Lord in a new light, and now just now hearing God put his covering over him, then what was Abram's response? And Abram said, Lord God, what wilt thou give me, seeing I go childless, and the steward of my house is this Eliezer of Damascus? And Abram said, behold, to me thou hast given no seed. Or behold, to me thou hast given no seed, and lo, one born in my house is mine heir. He's talking about Eliezer now. You realize that, right? I've got it in my notes here, but I'll just at least say this. I think his attitude is wrong. I think his tenor is wrong. I think his tone is wrong. But I'm so proud of him because it's like he has a compass in him for the firstborn, for Jesus, for Christ, for the crucified, for the son of the Father's love. I think he's got that. And no matter how much you hit him hard with bad stuff, it'll go back to that. And no matter how much good stuff's going on around him, his compass keeps going back. Yeah. I must have that firstborn son come out. So, remember, this story of Abraham is our story. It's supposed to be our story. What we're supposed to see from this is that there are a lot of ups and downs and things that distract us and things that will happen and all this kind of stuff, but we are supposed to keep our heart toward one thing, not being a great man of God. Abram's one of the great men of the Bible. God sees him as great because he was faithful to what his heart was to bring forth that son. Same with Mary, the mother of Jesus. Grateful that she was faithful to bring forth this, even though she didn't even understand him. 12-year-old sitting there. And they come in after looking everywhere for him. We're looking for Jesus. We're looking for Jesus. Going everywhere. Remember? Luke 2, we're looking for Jesus. Come in and see him sitting there. And why have you, similar to this right here, why have you treated your father and I thus? We have sought you sorrowing. And Jesus drops the bomb. I must be about my father's business. And they're going, you're going to be a carpenter? You're going to take up your father's business? No, they knew they was talking about something else. And they'd never, apparently had never heard that before, because they wondered and went, what is this? They did not understand what he was saying. When the son starts coming forth, a lot of people don't understand. Because the only way to understand this is in the father-son relationship. It is an eternal relationship that God will not back off and will be the measuring rod, because he's the judge of all things. Everything. See, we say Jesus is going to sit on a throne and he's going to look at our stuff, you know, and he's going to go, well, come on, you know, like that or something. You've heard his example was, all nations shall be brought before him, brought into one room, and he will divide the goats from the sheep. He's a lamb, a slaughtered lamb on the throne. And his judgment isn't checking out your works in that sense. It's of what sort they are. That's what it says. Are they goat works? Or are they lamb works? And sheep on the right hand, you know. And I know absolutely, you know, I'm sure we'll all be there, but I know absolutely the goats are going to be going, well, this isn't fair. Because you're a sheep. And you're just picking the sheep. And he knows that they know. Because he's made sure that we've heard that it is his son, that it is that nature, it is that what God wants out of us. And all that we do, you can do a million things and still have that spirit. It can still be giving that sweet incense of that son to the Father in anything you do. Or you can just do stuff. What do you do around the church? I do stuff. Oh, praise God, really? Yeah. Any incense? Nah. Don't mess with that stuff. Fires burn things down. No. The Father wants his son. And the Father wants in those who are bearing that son to have a compass in them that points no matter what happens, no matter good or bad, no matter happy or sad, that points to that son. I must, like Abraham. Here he is in the middle. I want the son. You have not given me the son. You call me your man. You bless me. You shield me. You do all this stuff. And he just said, I shield you. And this is his response. You shield me. You all this. And yes, you're a wonderful reward, but you promised the Son would come. That's a good prayer. I don't care if your attitude's wrong. He'll adjust your attitude if your compass is pointing in the right direction. He's faithful. He's faithful to his son. See, he's faithful to his son. And then, we know later on he gets off and he has a son trying to get the son, and it's Ishmael. It's not the son, right? It's the result of his flesh and Sarah's ideas on, well, maybe we should do this or whatever. No, we need to be waiting on the son to come forth. We need to trust him. We need to call out. We need to keep in tune. And if we do, then the Father, as I said, he is faithful to his son. You can be assured God will reveal his son in you. You do not have to continually fret like this guy, Abram, because he's fretting right now again. He's fretting maybe more than any point. Why? Because he's on the verge of being out of the game. He's getting older every day. Right? He's getting so old, he's going, kind of like Mike Wallace, I don't want to have a son because I can't keep up with him. Not really, he didn't say that. But that son, this, and we're not going to discuss it now, but these few verses in through here, he's going to have a new layer of revelation pertaining to the son now. So one was from Melchizedek and that, One was a new revelation pertaining to his God and to his nature and to his way. This is going to be a new revelation concerning directly tied to the Son that's within it. Yeah. So it's going to be good stuff. It won't be boring like tonight's class. All right, shall we pray? Lord, we are so desirous for your Son, and we want to step across that line, get on your side of the line, and say, we want the Son. And we know that's in your heart, and that's what you want, and you want him beyond just putting him in us so that we'd have a Savior or someone in there that can heal us or someone that can take care of our earthly life. You want him to be able to live, to be able to come forth out of bondage to our hearts. And so we do, we do, we do, we mean it. We ask you, Father, bring forth your Son out of us. We're born again. He's in us. Bring him forth out of us in ways that will bring you joy because you're his Father. In ways that will bring us joy, that we're a vehicle of giving you your Son. So thank you, Father. Thank you for your incredible faithfulness to Jesus, the Son. We're going to trust in that, your incredible faithfulness to your Son, not our ups and downs, not our failures, not our apparent bad situations. But we will soon find that they all will work to conform us to the image of that Son. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. In Jesus' name. Amen.